What go on YouTube? This your brethren. No, what's going on YouTube? This is your brother, your friend, Apostle Makhario. As you can see, once again, it's a beautiful day out here in Michigan. So I decided to come out to the park. This is part 3 of our witchcraft topic. Witches, warlocks, magic, black magic, Santeria, voodoo, all of that other... I can't call it good stuff. All of that other stuff that people do when they're worshiping a false god. So we're going to get right into it. Try to keep this short, hopefully. You know, I try, people. It's a beautiful day, so, you know, it always puts you in a good mood, even though I try to keep my mind on the Lord as is. So we're going to go right into it. We're going to 1 Kings chapter 18, verses 17 through 40. Yeah, we got some studying to do. 17 through 40. We are talking about, this is the prophet Elijah. And just in case some of you all don't know, he was the gentleman that was carried up in the chariot of fire. So ladies and gentlemen, for all of you who hear about a chariot of fire, and you know, a lot of what the devil does is he allows people who are serving him to put it in their songs and use it, and people never understand where it actually comes from. Well, I'm not going to take you there right now, but if you continue to study through Kings, the story or the account of Elijah, you'll see that he was carried up in a chariot of fire, and then God had left him another prophet who was doing exactly basically what he did and somewhat greater, who was Elisha. If you all haven't seen it, I've covered it in probably some other videos before, but this is about Elijah, Ahab, Jezebel, and the prophets of Baal, or false gods. I can't even call them prophets of Baal. They called them that, but they were really warlocks, people who practice witchcraft, black magic, and the arts. So, getting into it. Prophet Elijah, we're going to start at verse 17. And it came to pass when Ahab saw Elijah that Ahab said unto him, art thou he that troubleth Israel? Verse 18, and he answered, I have not troubled Israel. This is Elijah, the prophet Elijah talking. Now, I have not troubled Israel, but thou art thy father's house, and that ye have forsaken the commandments of the Lord, and thou hast followed Balaam. Okay, another false god. Now therefore send and gather to me all Israel unto Mount Carmel, and the prophets of Baal 450, and the prophets of groves 400, which eat at Jezebel's table. Of course, Jezebel is a very, very demonic spirit. I told you all before how Jezebel works. She makes men subservient to women, and she makes women try to be the man in the relationship, or try to take control over the man in the relationship. That's how the spirit of Jezebel works. Verse 20, so Ahab, who was the king at the time, and this is what I was explaining to you all about the weight of the words of the man of God. In the Old Testament, and which it should be now today, the kings and the pharaohs and people used to go to men of God because they can prove that our God existed. They can prove that our God was more powerful than the ones that they worshiped, the false gods that they worshiped. So Ahab, being the king, listened to Elijah. So it says in verse 20, so Ahab sent unto the children of Israel and gathered all the prophets together unto Carmel. And Elijah came unto all the people and said, how long will ye halt between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him. And the people answered him not a word. They understand he was speaking with authority. And they already knew about Elijah and the things that God had used him to do. Verse 22, then said Elijah unto the people, I, even I, only remain a prophet of the Lord, but Baal's prophets are 450. So that means 450 people were worshiping a false god and were following after Baal. Okay? Verse 23, let them therefore, well, the ones that were supposed to be leading the people, there were more people following after Baal, but those were the main ones. Just like we have ministers and preachers, and the Catholics have priests and whoever else that are leading them the wrong way. Elijah was saying, I'm the only one left of the prophet of the Lord, which he was speaking from his own accord in that sense. Later on, as you study the account, you'll see that God spoke to him, that there were more hidden that followed after God with all their heart. that have not bowed their knee to Baal. Verse 23, let them therefore give us two bullocks, and let them choose one bullock for themselves, and cut it in pieces, and lay it on wood, and put on fire, and put no fire under. And I will dress the other bullock, and lay it on wood, and put no fire under. And call ye on the name of your gods. This is for you witches, warlocks, those of you that practice black magic, voodoo, white magic, whatever you want to call it. He was saying here, and I'm telling you, call on the name of your gods. As he said here, and I will call on the name of the Lord. And the God that answereth by fire, let him be God. And all the people answered and said, it is well spoken. So that means there was an agreement between the prophet Elijah, who served the true and the living God, and the prophets or sorcerers of Baal, who served their false gods. And they said, fine, we're not going to put any fire. And whichever God answers by fire, we're going to know that that's the true and the living God. Okay? Verse 25, and Elijah said unto the prophets of Baal, choose ye one bullock for yourselves and dress it first, for ye are many, and call on the name of your gods, but put no fire under it. So verse 26, and they took the bullock which was given them and dressed it and called on the name of Baal from morning, early morning, until noon, saying, O Baal, hear us. But there was no voice, nor any that answered. And they leaped upon the altar which was made. So they got so desperate that they started jumping on the altar, calling on this false god, who didn't use his voice, didn't do anything, okay? And this is where I tell you that when it comes to cutting, for you cutters and you self-harm people, that's of another spirit. That's not the spirit of God. It started from witchcraft. It started from false worship. So if you're in depression and you feel like cutting is going to help you get out of that depression, that's not the way to go. That's Satan's way of taking you out early so you can end up in hell with him and the rest of the fallen angels and the demons that are there. Verse 27, you're about to see it in verse 27 and 28. And it came to pass at noon that Elijah mocked them. So what I do to those of you who follow witchcraft and practice black magic is exactly what the prophet before me did. that's why, for those of you who are Christian who don't understand why I would do that and why I tell you I don't live in fear, this is why. I study the Word of God. I understand the Word of God. I understand the power that comes in serving God the Father through Jesus Christ the Son. It says here in verse 27, and it came to pass at noon that Elijah mocked them. So now he's starting to make fun of them. And said, cry aloud, for he is a god. Either he is talking, or he is pursuing, or he is in a journey, or peradventure he sleepeth. Maybe he's saying, maybe he sleeps and must be awaked. So, excuse me. He's telling them, it's kind of funny, it's very funny actually. He's telling them to cry louder to the false god that you worship. Call upon, for those of you who worship money, call upon your money. Cry louder, maybe money will answer you and get you out of your trouble. For those of you who are serving false gods, cry louder. Maybe that false god will answer you and get you out of trouble. Verse 28, and this is where the cutting part comes in, where God didn't call us to cut ourselves if we're in depression. He called us to follow after him and actually turn to him, because he'll keep you from being in depression. Verse 28, and they cried aloud and cut themselves after the manner with knives and lancelets till the blood gushed out upon them. So ladies and gentlemen, this is where self-harm, for those of you that are younger that are watching this YouTube video, or even some of you that are older in your 20s or 30s, self-harm and cutting yourself does not come into play. It doesn't help at all. But serving God through Jesus Christ will get you out of that depression. God will answer. He will bless you. He will change your life. But you have to allow yourselves. So for those of you that are cutting yourselves, that are following after false gods and don't want to believe in God the Father or Jesus the Christ, that's not the way to go. That's not going to help you. Like I said before, all it's going to do is Satan is trying to draw you and pull you into hell before your time, so that way you have no chance of repentance, or you have no chance to turn and see your life change. Because what Satan does is he takes away the hope that is in you. And if you don't have hope, then you feel like there's no reason to live. But I promise you that as true as God is, there is a reason to live. So in verse 28, they cried aloud, cut themselves after the manner with knives and lancelets till the blood gushed out upon them. So you see where that comes from. Cutting is not of God. It's not a way to relieve your depression. It's not a way to relieve your stress. It's not a way to live at all. Actually, it's not living. Verse 29, let's get back into this witchcraft thing. So as you all see, that comes from witchcraft. That's my point. Verse 29, and it came to pass when midday was passed, and the prophet and they prophesied until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice. So they went past noon all the way into evening, still trying to call on this false god Baal, still trying to get him to answer. Verse 29, the evening sacrifice, that there was neither voice nor any to answer, nor any that regarded. So they're saying there was no god that paid them any mind, if there was a god that actually existed whom they were serving. Verse 30, and Elijah said unto all the people, come near unto me. So now the true man of God is calling them to come unto him. And he starts to do what God called him to do. And all the people came near unto him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down, because they had done that serving their false god. And Elijah took 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, unto whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. And with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made a trench about the altar, as great as would contain 2 measures of seed. And he put the wood in order, and cut the bullock in pieces, and laid him on the wood, and said, fill 4 barrels of water, and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood. So before he even called on God, he's showing them how great our God and how powerful our God is through Jesus Christ. Of course, Jesus had not died on the cross at that time, but I'm telling you that because he was from the beginning and he is in the end. So I want you all to understand the whole measure and the breadth of who God is. And actually, even that doesn't explain all of God, because God encompasses everything. But so verse 34, and he said unto them, do it the second time. And they did it the second time, and he said, do it a third time. And they did it a third time. So he had them pour 4 barrels of water 3 times over the sacrifice before he even prayed, because he knew God was going to answer. Now, how many of us, I love you, Jesus, how many of us have that type of faith where we know that regardless of the situation, we know our God is going to answer? How many of us are walking in that place with God that we can tell them, go off and pour 4 barrels of water 3 times on it, so that is drenched now, that is soaked, because he knew, he understood that God was going to answer. Now, this is where you have power with God. Not only do you have power in God, but now you're in a place where you have power with God. So he knew within himself that he had power with God, or that God was going to answer what came out of his mouth. So, verse 35, and the water ran down upon the altar, and he filled the trench also with water. So he did even more. He filled the trench with water now. And it came to pass at that time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, or Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. Sorry, verse 36. Let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. So God was using the prophet Elijah to try to bring them back to God. Many times people are quick to forget what God has done for them the minute that God begins to bless them. And so God has to use someone who stands in a righteous place, in a holy place with God, to bring people back to God. Because many times, as the children of Israel did, even when I told you about the story of Moses, once they left out of Egypt and out of bondage with all the silver and the gold, Moses wasn't gone for more than 40 days. And they had already started making a false god and saying that this calf is what brought them out of Egypt with a mighty hand. Like I said, people are quick to forget when God begins to bless them and they get free. So God was using Elijah to draw the people back, the children of Israel, back to God. Verse 38, then the fire of the Lord fell. So God answered immediately. It says, then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust, and licked up all the water that was in the trench. So God did more than what he even... Oh, man, I love you, Jesus. God did more than what even Elijah told them. All Elijah said was, the God that answers by fire. So Elijah prayed, and our God answered and consumed the burnt sacrifice, or the bullock. He consumed the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up the water that was in the trench. We know that the Bible declares in Hebrews 12:29 in the New Testament, our God is a consuming fire. So that was the consuming fire of God, because the Bible declares in verse 38 that the Lord, then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed. That means there was nothing left. Okay, verse 39. And when the people saw it, they fell on their face and they said, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is the God. And Elijah said unto them, take the prophets of Baal, or all of the warlocks. Let not one of them escape. And they took them, the people, okay? And Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and slew them there. So as I told you in part two of the witchcraft topic that I'm helping you all to understand, and those of you who are practicing black magic and witchcraft and serving a false god, in part two in the Old Testament, God used to tell us to slay them. The minute that they came in our presence, the Lord said, you shall not suffer a witch to live. And I gave you all that scripture before in part two. So here, after God answered by fire, because they had gone through everything calling on their God, they called on Baal from the morning, the Bible declares, until the time of the evening sacrifice. So after, it has to be more than 6 hours, we'll put it that way. They had called on their God. Their God, who's a false God, did not answer at all. Elijah prayed, and our God answered by fire and consumed not only the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, and the water. Okay? Because remember, he had them soak it in water. And then in verse 40, Elijah told the people, take all of the false prophets, take all of the people that serve and worship a false god, take Baal, take those that practice black magic. And they took them down to the brook, and the Bible declares that he slew them. So that means he killed them there. Okay? And Elijah said unto Ahab, well, we were supposed to stop at 40, but I'll read one more. And Elijah said unto Ahab, get thee up, eat and drink, for there is an abundance of rain. Now, for you all to understand that verse, you have to understand that Elijah had so much power with God that Elijah went to Ahab, who was the king at the time, and he said, there's not going to be any rain on the earth until I say so. Okay? So the Bible declares that it did not rain for 3.5 years that people suffered because there was a false... okay, I can't say it. Well, they were serving a false god, and there was a person in power, which we see all over the world now, that follow after false gods. Even in the United States, even in Europe, all these people follow after false gods, and their god is money, or they're serving Baal, or they're going after people, or serving people who are not even gods, basically. The same thing that happened here. As they called on Baal, he didn't answer him. So Elijah started to mock him. Call on your God. Pray unto your God. Maybe he sleeps. Maybe he's on a journey. Because that's when you know, when you worship something that you created, you know it's not a God. You would actually be its God. So it's amazing to me how people in other countries create things and they fall down and worship it, even though they made it with their hands. But once again, that's people being deceived. And that's why we need people of God that are strong in God and living a righteous and holy life to help manifest the glory of God, as Elijah did here before the people in Israel. He manifested the glory of God when he prayed to God. And the Bible didn't declare that Elijah lifted up his voice and cried loud. He didn't cut himself to get God's attention. He did not do all of these things that these people were doing that were serving the false gods. So for you witches and warlocks and all you people that practice Wicca, Santeria, etc., it's no good. It's no power in it. The only power is in God. And actually, it's funny, because this morning, as I was in my studies, David said in Psalm 62:11, he said, God hath spoken once, twice have I heard this, that power belongeth unto God. So no other God that you worship has power. Money doesn't give you power. People think it does. There was a song, and I teach this many years ago, that there was a song, Money, Power, Respect, for those of you who were in the rap community, and you heard it many, many years ago. I was actually young when this came out. But money doesn't give you power or respect. The Bible declares that money is a shield, but it does not give you power. If it gave you power, as I told you all before, Michael Jackson would not have died. Rockefeller would not have died. All of these people that have all this power, they would not be dying from diseases and all of these terrible things that God could heal them from had they not worshipped the false god of money. So, here, as I told you all before, for those of you that are in witchcraft, that practice black magic, I am beseeching you, I'm begging you, I'm imploring you to turn away from those false gods and serve the true and the living God. Serving nature, or going out into nature and saying nature is your God and praying to the sun for you Indians, or Native American Indians. There are other cultures of people that do these things as well, but praying to the God of the wind and the God of the sun and the God of the earth and the God of the dirt and the God of the trees. These are all false gods. There's only one God. And the only way to God is through Jesus Christ our Lord. As Jesus said in John 14 and 6, verily I say unto you, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So, Jesus Christ is the only way to God the Father. So, ladies and gentlemen, I love you all. I will see you all again soon. This tied into part two. Part two tied into part one. And as we continue, of course, there were going to be other parts because there's so much more. I'm trying to get off of this topic of witchcraft sometime soon. But I have to give you all enough, especially for those of you that are Christian, I have to give you all enough ammunition to understand that nothing that happens can hurt you. God allows it. You may be going through a tough time, but no witchcraft, no voodoo, no black magic. If you have faith in God and you're living righteous and holy and you're doing your best to keep your heart pure before God, none of it can work against you. I'm sure since I've been doing this topic, there are witches and warlocks that have seen this, and maybe they tried stuff, but as I told you all before, I've dealt with witches and warlocks. Nothing happened. I'm serving God. I'm living good. Life is still good. God is still blessing. And the Bible declares, so you all understand, in Proverbs 26 and 2, as the bird by wandering and as the swallow by flying, so the curse causeless shall not come. People that do black magic and witchcraft and voodoo and etc., Wicca, all this nonsense, they're trying to put curses on you causeless. Now, if there's a cause, or you have a hole in your umbrella, as we call it in ministry, or a hole in your covering, and you've been doing things you should not be doing, then the curse could quite possibly come to pass. So it's best to live a holy, a righteous, a pure life that you can be just as bold as I am, because that's the thing that I'm trying to get people all around the world to understand, that there is boldness in God the Father. There's boldness in Jesus Christ. You don't have to be timid about anything. I actually had an interview with a lady yesterday over the phone about another job, and I told her from Jump Street, look, I'm a minister, okay, so my morals and my values are gonna run into me doing that job for you, and in me doing that job, you're gonna understand there's gonna be a different standard. And so, you know, people like to separate church and the government, and it's not possible. You can't take God out of anything. God is in everything. The rainbow is a sign that God created, as I told you all before. Many people don't know that because they've never studied the Bible, but the rainbow is a sign. It's a covenant between God and man that God will never destroy the whole earth with water again. So, ladies and gentlemen, I want you all to understand, being a Christian should tie into your everyday life in everything. There should not be any part of your life that Christianity and your belief in God does not play a factor. So, as I tell you all before, 2 Timothy 1 and 7, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. So, ladies and gentlemen, curse causeless shall not come. You can send this to all the witches and the warlocks you know, everybody that practice Wicca. You can send this to people in Africa that do voodoo and black magic. Nothing is going to happen. I'm going to continue to teach you all about God the Father through Jesus Christ and understand that I'm covered. So I pray that you all understand, and those of you that are serving false gods, I pray that you come to Jesus Christ and come to know him as your personal Lord and Savior, that your life can change. You don't have to be angry. You don't have to be bitter. You don't have to be upset. You don't have to have unforgiveness. You don't have to do these things. God is a God of love. He'll help you forgive. If you've been molested, if you've been abused and beat, God will give you strength. As long as you follow him and you desire to let it go, God will help you let it go. So I love you all. I will see you all again soon. I got to enjoy this day, practice some of my parkour, do some backflips and things of that nature. Love you all. See you all again soon. God bless. I am out until next week.